Our story starts with a boy who has shut himself off from the world to escape the relentless bullying that he faces every day. As he lay in his bed scrolling Reddit with no future plans and no aspirations, a bright light suddenly shines from his phone and he is greeted by a goddess with a huge personality. She congratulates him on being selected to reincarnate into a new world, and he now realizes that he must have died in his room and ended up here. The goddess cuts straight to the chase and tells him that she'll give him a chi power to make his life easy in the new world. She must feel bad that he ended up as a shut-in in his last life. The guy takes it all in and declares that there is only one thing that he wants in his next life, that is for it to be peaceful. He still wants to be a shut-in, just without the bullying part, so he agrees to be reincarnated. He wakes up as a baby and a king is standing above him. Happy to have such a healthy boy, he praises the boy for being so healthy and having the royal mark on his chest, but then they measure his magic power. The king thinks that his power should be really high since he is a royal, maybe 40 or 50. But once it is measured, the orb only shows a power level of 2, and he has no attributes except barrier magic. So it seems that the boy was born with low magic capabilities, but his parents should still love him, right? Nope, they are worried about their image as royals for giving birth to such a weak baby. And just like that, they make plans to throw the baby. Looks like this guy can't catch a break. He was reincarnated into a new world only for him to speed run life. Meanwhile, the goddess is panicking that they are about to throw the baby. She gave him a cheat power, but they misunderstood it. She actually gave him a magic power of 1002, but the measurements they use can only show 2 digits, so he's going to be killed on a misunderstanding. The baby has been left in the forest and he cannot move since while he's a baby. He tries to think of a plan for his survival and remembers that the measurements said he could use barrier magic. He starts imagining a barrier and light begins to congregate above him. And finally, a box is formed in the air. He remarks that magic is actually pretty easy to use, so he plays around with its capabilities and he is able to change its size, shape, and color. He is also able to apply it to himself and levitate, so now he's a floating baby. But then, a giant wolf appears behind him and tries to chomp down on him, but the barrier is strong enough to hold it off. Since he is safe, he thinks of a plan of attack and forms several barriers to attack the wolf, but the barriers aren't able to do much on their own. So if he switches tactics and starts chucking trees at the problem, but the wolf still manages to get up, so he brings out the big guns and prepares to drop an island on it. The wolf knew it was outmatched when the baby started chucking islands at it and decided to give up. Later, the wolf apologizes for trying to eat him. She just wanted to regain some magic power, but she didn't know he would start throwing land at her. He tries to respond, but he is still a baby, so he can't talk at all. He thinks of a way to solve the problem and creates a barrier that can create sound and puts it in his throat so that he can talk through it. He greets the wolf and she asks who he is, what he is doing in the forest as a baby. He introduces himself as Heart and tells her that he was yeeted by the palace since they thought his magic power was too low, but the wolf sees that he has power that far exceeds the limits of a human being. She deduces that he must be the reincarnation of the demon lord, and while he is actually just a shut-in, he plays along and declares himself as the demon lord. The wolf is now terrified and accepts her death willingly, but he doesn't want to kill, he just doesn't want her to eat him. She is moved by his generosity in sparing her life and swears to serve him loyally for the rest of her life. Heart just wants to be done with this and agrees with her and calls her Flay so that he can leave. But as he is floating away, she calls him back and informs him that a contract has been created between them since he named her Flay. While he was trying to explain that he didn't mean to create a contract, a problem arises and he falls to the ground. He hasn't had anything to eat milk since he was born and is starving. He asks Flay to help him and she does her best and turns into a human, but she is naked. Heart is embarrassed if he uses a barrier to make some clothes for Flay, and Flay once again tries to provide him with breast milk, but her logic is a little off as she wants to mate with a 2-hour-old baby. Later, Flay apologizes for her rash behavior and Heart forgives her, but then someone is heard approaching them from a distance. Flay wants to kill them immediately, but she is stopped by Heart, who wants to at least talk to them first. He creates 2 barriers that act as communication devices and asks Flay to confront the approacher. The person is a man, and when Flay asks him why he is in the forest, he says he is here to collect the baby. Flay refuses to hand him over and the man asks why she cares so much. She then proudly exclaims that she is serving the baby. The man is just here to rescue Heart since he is a relative of the king and can't just sit by and let the baby die. He even brought fresh titty milk for him to drink before he starves to death. Flay is angry that he went up to her since she can't make any milk, but Heart just wants the milk before he starves to death. Flay asks him why he wants to rescue the baby, and he responds that it's because he lost his own child and he can't just let a baby die in the forest because the king abandoned it. He wants to let the baby live in peace. Flat is moved by this story and starts crying her eyes out, and the man finds her behavior to be strange for a demon. Since she has made the baby her master, he makes a deal with her to hire her as a servant so that she can watch over the baby as much as she wants to, and Flay agrees to his terms. They then destroy the cradle to make it look like Heart died in the forest, then, to make it believable, he rips off Heart's cloth and pours animal blood on it to sell the cover, but Heart still hasn't gotten his milk yet. It has been 9 years since that night, and Heart greets his new family in the morning. They treat him very well, and he loves them dearly. But there is one problem. Even though he has been living with them all this time, he is still hated by his little sister, and he didn't even do anything to her. Flay walks in, dressed in a maid outfit, and prepares to serve the family their breakfast, and surprisingly, the little girl likes Flay a lot. Which only rubs salt in the wounds of Heart, who has no idea why she doesn't like him. She asks Flay to play with her later, and she initially refuses, but then Heart orders her to play with the girl, so she agrees to the play date. The girl is ecstatic that she gets to play with Flay, and later, she chases Flay in the garden and has a wonderful time. Heart is watching them from a distance and feeling left out, but then his mother comes up to him and tries to cheer him up, telling him that his sister, Charlotte, only avoids him because she doesn't know how to approach boys around her age. So it's not because of anything that he has done after all, she is really attached to Flay. But Heart fears that something worse might be going on. Maybe Charlotte knows that he is actually nearly 30 years old inside and thinks he is a creep. He falls to his knees in defeat, and his mother tries to cheer him up again by suggesting that they go shopping to buy a gift for Charlotte. After all, if there is one way to win over a kid's affection, it's bribery. But shopping is a bit too advanced for someone with absolutely zero social skills. But his mother is adamant that it will be a good experience for him, since he is always in his room. And one day he is going to be an heir to the castle, so he needs to go touch grass, and as his mother, she will support him all the way. Later, Heart is in his room with a clone of himself right next to him. He contemplates leaving the castle permanently, but if he leaves he has to take FLE with him, and Charlotte loves FLE, so she would be sad if she left. But if he left FLE behind, she would most likely end herself, since her whole purpose in life is to watch over Heart. But if he stays, they are eventually going to put a bunch of responsibility on his shoulders, something he really doesn't want. In the past 9 years, he has been researching the capabilities of his barrier magic, and now he is able to make a clone of himself with it, but the clones still can't talk or move on their own. Just then, his father knocks on his door and asks him to come outside to learn the way of the sword for a bit, exactly what Heart didn't want responsibility. His father wants to train him in the way of the sword since he still thinks that Heart's magic power is extremely low. He has to be good at something, so Heart tries to use his research as an excuse, and his father is supportive, but he still wants Heart to at least try the sword first. He is supposed to attack, but his father is known as a war hero, so he doesn't expect to be able to get a hit on him. For now, he covers himself in a barrier so that he doesn't get hurt badly, and then lunges at his dad. He surprises him and ends up smashing his sword on the ground and leaving a pretty big hole. He now takes an attack stance and tells Heart to try avoiding his strike, and Heart leaps into the air and dodges it. This is really surprising since normally you would need to be at least level 30 to dodge that strike. Heart does think that it is strange since even when he checked his magic power and a crystal that went up to 3 digits, it still only showed 2, and the highest number ever recorded for a human is 77, so how can he be so strong? His dad brushes it off and is now determined to turn Heart into the best sword user he can be. And Heart can do nothing but go along with it. Later that night, the man is done training Heart and has a chat with his wife about Heart's power and comes to the conclusion that Heart might be part demon. There are records showing that long ago, someone in the royal family clapped some demon cheeks, and now there's a rare chance for members of the royal family to be born with demonic traits. His wife protests that Heart can't be a demon since he doesn't have a horn or tail, but he does have strange power and a demon servant, but these guys are decent parents, they aren't going to abandon Heart like some other baby-throwing people. They want him to be happy, and Charlotte overhears their conversation. Some time passes, and Haruto is up in his room chilling. He wonders why his father has been so busy lately, but then again, and being busy means less sword training for himself, so he can't complain. He hears a commotion downstairs and goes to check it out, and upon exiting the castle, he sees a bunch of badly wounded men laying on the ground, and his father seated like he just lost a game of poker and gambled away his life savings. He asks what happened here, and his dad informs him that they had set out to lay waste to a band of thieves. They planned ahead of time, got the right equipment, and even laid an ambush. But yet, they still bat their ass handed to them by a bunch of thieves. His father doesn't want to be seen in his shame of defeat, so he asks Haruto to go back inside. Haruto turns to leave and FLE starts roasting his father for being trash since he was beaten by mere thieves. But trash or not, he is still Haruto's father, so he was FLE one morning to shut her mouth, where she may not have a mouth to shut anymore. He continues walking, and as he goes he heals all the soldiers. That night, Flay is standing outside Haruto's room and he can't get any sleep because of it. He opens the door and asks her what she's doing, but she doesn't answer because of the warning he gave her earlier. He tells her that she can speak now. He's not angry at her anymore, but he can't let the attack on his father slide, so he's going to deal with the thieves himself. On the roof, he uses his surveillance barriers to scan the city for any signs of the thieves, and he finds them out in the woods having a drink. He wonders how they were able to defeat his dad's army, and Flay suggests that there might be a spy among them. Not that it matters much since none of them are going to live past the next 10 minutes. With that, he flies off into the sky with Flay, and as he goes, his little sister spots him. At the thieves' camp, Buttooth over here is praising their captain for forcing Haruto's father to retreat, and he starts gloating about returning to his home country after killing him. However, unbeknownst to him, Haruto was standing there and heard the whole thing. He freezes them in place with his barriers, but then Buttooth starts running his mouth, and we already know Haruto has no patience for needless chatter. His conditions are simple. Answer his questions truthfully or have all 206 bones shattered. After his interrogation, he finds out that the thieves are actually soldiers from the neighboring empire who were tasked with pretending to be thieves and attacking to cause mayhem. The captain starts begging for his life since he has said everything he knows, but Haruto, unlike Batman, has a no loose ends policy. He orders Flay to burn down the entire fort and the people along with it. As he walks away, he decides to send his father an anonymous letter tipping him off to the neighboring empire's plans. The next day, Haruto's father has received the letter and has confirmed that the thieves' fort had been burnt down. Charlotte asks him who could have done it, but he has already figured out by now that Flay was the one that burned the fort down. Upon hearing this, Charlotte runs off to go find Flay and ask her what Haruto actually is. Last night she saw him fly off. When she went to his room, his clone was in his bed. Flay takes the opportunity to brag about Haruto's immense power. Later, Flay tells Haruto everything that happened with Charlotte, and Haruto now realizes that Charlotte must be incredibly suspicious of him. From that moment on, she keeps following him around wherever he goes, even when he's taking a bath. She keeps it up for an entire week, and by the end of it, Haruto is now spying on her too. During breakfast the next day, Haruto finds out that his mother and Charlotte are going to be going on a trip together. But later in his room, the surveillance barriers that he set on Charlotte start going off because she's being attacked right now. Their guards got jumped and the assailants are now after them. Natalia is doing her best to defend Charlotte, but there is no way she could handle four guys at once. A barrier appears on Charlotte's ear and suddenly has a good idea of where to go, as if she is receiving instructions. His mother wonders where Charlotte is receiving instructions from, but she's not going to complain about being saved. They get to the edge of a cliff and Charlotte says to jump down, and left with no other choice, she jumps off the cliff and runs into the cave Charlotte had been directed to. And this is where she makes the dumbest decision I've seen all day. She leaves Charlotte in the cave in order to go find the person that was directing Charlotte and is almost immediately captured. She now decides that it's not worth it to be captured, so she is prepared to offer herself. Haruto arrives just in time to save her from herself, and now he's really angry, so he blasts the attackers away. He then heads into the cave to speak with Charlotte, and he tries disguising his voice to keep his identity secret, but she already recognizes his aura and calls out to him as her brother. She asks him if he is a hero of justice, and he just plays along with it for now. He's still got to go deal with the attackers, you know, no loose ends policy and all. Harvino returns home where his father is receiving a report on what happened. He tries to play it off like he had no involvement, but Gold is still suspicious. He realizes that the Imperial soldiers must have been led into the kingdom by a mole on his side. Not long after, Charlotte and Natalia return and are greeted warmly by Gold, and Charlotte has finally warmed up to Haruto. Haruto is happy to finally have his sister's love, but FLE is jealous. From then on, Charlotte has been clinging to Haruto nonstop. She barges into his room and sees him looking at the surveillance barriers he has set up, and she thinks it's ancient magic. Haruto goes along with it to get the discussion over with, but Charlotte tells him that she knows where he can get some books on ancient magic. She takes him to the library, and he is amazed that he has never seen it despite living here longer than Charlotte. She grabs a stool and starts picking out books related to ancient magic for him, and they sit down to read it. Charlotte wants him to read one of the books to her, so she sits on his lap to get the full Big Brother experience. While reading, he gets reminded of anime and starts complaining about how he never gets to watch anything new in this world. Charlotte has no idea what he's talking about, so she asks him to explain what anime it is. He starts explaining it to her. But to Charlotte, it sounds like a fake fan trying to explain the correct watch order. Herbito worries that she's going to think he is weird now, but she is just even more excited to see something like that. And with that smile, Herbito knew that by any means necessary, he had to let Charlotte watch anime. Fast forward 2 weeks and Herbito somehow managed to get an internet connection to Japan. He wants to give Charlotte a chance to watch anime, so he logs into his streaming service and creates a child account to spare her the trauma of watching Boku no Pico. She gets her first look at anime, and she is entranced by the colorful moving pictures, but there is one problem, she doesn't understand Japanese. Haruto thinks it might be hard for her to learn Japanese, but Charlotte is a goddamn genius and masters it in just 2 hours. After 2 weeks, Charlotte has turned full on weeb and Haruto is worried that she might turn out like him at this rate. So he decides to be strict with her and limit her watch time to only 3 hours a day. Charlotte is bummed out that she can't binge the whole season, but this is a necessary precaution to make sure she doesn't turn into a neat. Pormuto tells her to hurry up and come downstairs for dinner and at the dinner table. Charlotte is really sleepy thanks to all her watch time up to this point. His parents ask him what he has been doing with Charlotte to make her so sleepy, but she just answers that she's been helping him with his ancient magic research. After dinner, Charlotte keeps following Haruto around in hopes of him letting her watch some more anime, but no means no. He tells her to just go take her bath and head to bed already. Later, Haruto is also taking a bath and Charlotte is there as well. While bathing, Charlotte notices the royal crest on his chest, but he tells her to keep that a secret and after they finish, Haruto heads to bed. But he can't sleep since Charlotte crawled into his bed while he wasn't looking and from the corner of his eye, he can see his mother shipping them by the doorway. She is a firm believer of it's not incest if you're not blood related. The next day, Gold heads into battle to take care of the rest of the thieves and Charlotte is now sad that he has to go. Later she asks Haruto why he can't just go and solve all the problems with his power and she's basically asking him to create world peace. He wanted to keep out of all fights that didn't directly involve him, but if that's what his sister wants, then he will do it. She also asks him to become a Power Ranger and if he's going to fight crime, he might as well go all the way. He sets up a camera for Charlotte to watch and flies off only to find the thieves hiding in a cave so he beats them up. He is then spotted by Gold who realizes that he is a little late to the party. When asked about his motives, he just says he is here for justice, but internally he dies of cringe. As time passes and he continues to beat up bad guys, he has become known as the Black Knight. Dark Knight was already copyrighted. After some time, Haruto has finally perfected his clone and it is really similar to him, but when Flay comes to tell him to come downstairs, the clone is also similar in Haruto's laziness. Haruto goes downstairs where his father is greeting the princess and prince, his biological siblings. The prince is a little piece of shit and the fact that he will become king went to his head. He sees Haruto and decides to assert dominance by dueling him. The duel starts and Haruto scans the prince's level, and he actually has a pretty high level cap for this world, but that's still nothing compared to Haruto's 1002. The prince lunges at Haruto. With a level difference, he is too slow to actually hit him. However, he gets pissy about Haruto dodging, so Haruto just puts his shield around himself and takes the beating. However, the prince got too cocky and mocked him for not fighting back, which then prompted him to lay this smack down on him. He tries to fight back, but he keeps getting bodied so much that he resorts to using magic. However, something so weak does not affect him and he can just absorb it all. If the prince wants to throw around fire, then Haruto would be more than happy to show him how. But the prince has been scared out of his mind and gives up. With that out of the way that night, Charlotte has really gotten interested in this whole crime-fighting thing. She spots some bandits doing bandit things and she asks Haruko to go deal with them. Just then, FLE barges into the room to aid in crime-fighting. Charlotte is hyped that FLE is going to be joining in on their crime-fighting operations. She is going to be the Robin to his Batman. Before they head out, Haruto warns FLE that she has to keep things PG and she agrees to keep the violence down. They pull up on the bandits and Haruto introduces himself as the Black Knight and FLE as the Crimson Knight. But then FLE forgets all about the PG rating and just starts burning the bandits to death. Haruto tries to stop her, but she's still chucking fireballs like there is no tomorrow. He finally gets her to stop and tells her to head home for now. The bandits have had enough. Haruto is exhausted from having to both fight and save the bandits. But Charlotte and Flay are already planning the next attack. The next day, The prince is still all pissy about losing the fight to Haruto, but he realizes that he was stronger than what someone who is supposed to be level 2 should be. Just then, his butler comes in and tells him that he has to get ready for the banquet that evening. The butler also tells the prince to ask Charlotte to accompany him on the tour he's going to take tomorrow. The prince doesn't see a reason to take Charlotte since he isn't particularly fond of her, but the butler insists, so he ends up agreeing. After the banquet, Charlotte barges into Haruto's room with the clone that he sent to the banquet. The clone may have been made to deal with this kind of stuff, but it is just as antisocial as Haruto, so that banquet was the equivalent of torture. The clone is done for the day and jumps onto the bed. Charlotte tells Haruto that the prince asked her to accompany him on his tour, and hearing this, Haruto has to take some precautions. He scopes out the route of the tour and finds some cloaked people doing a ritual. He goes up to them and asks if they have a permit for their cult summoning ritual, but they get defensive and attack him. He decimated them, but they still had a trump card up their sleeves and summoned skeleton soldiers. Black Mag is able to destroy all the skeletons in a single strike, but they reformed themselves rather quickly, and no matter how many times he does it, it kept getting up. He then notices the cores on them and messes with it a little to get them to attack the others. The leader now has no choice but to summon his real trump card, a golem. Horbido is amazed to see a real golem, but his awe leaves him vulnerable to the golem's fist. He is knocked back and smashes into a tree, and after he regains his composure, he is then able to see the golem's weak spot on its chest, so he chucks a spike into it. The golem stops moving and the summoners are shocked that it failed. After some moments, it starts moving again and is now attacking the summoners. Horbido has rewritten the golem's magic formula, so now the summoners are out of trump cards. He hits the skeletons to tie them up and interrogates the leader on who he works for. But the guy isn't answering. Haruto isn't much of a people's person, so he gets straight to the point. Tell me the truth or I bury your team. Hearing the pleas of his subordinates, the leader finally cracks and discloses that they are part of the Queen's summoner team. Haruto probes further and the leader reveals that their plan was to attack the Tour tomorrow and assassinate Charlotte. The quitting fears that Charlotte will one day grow too powerful and end up challenging her power. Haruto has now pieced together and all the recent trouble has been the doing of the Queen. There are a lot of things going through his mind right now, but one thing is certain. That bitch is gonna pay. He lets his emotions get the best of him and causes the golem to start smashing the summoner into walls. Now with a clear mind, he thinks of the Queen, and even if she is his biological mother, he's done playing Batman. He's taking the Punisher road. The next day, the tour goes on as planned, but the awkwardness is immense. Charlotte tries to break the ice by telling Prince Laius that he doesn't have to be too upset about losing to Haruto, since he never stood a chance to begin with, but that just rubs salt in the wound. After accepting his defeat, Laius is a lot less of a brat and is just interested in knowing how Haruto can be so strong. With no other explanation, they speculate that Haruto might be part demon, but there are no signs of any demon traits. Charlotte confirms that Haruto has no demon traits and she can guarantee it since she has bathed with him, shocking the siblings. Charlotte asks if there is something wrong with it, but Laius says it's not necessarily wrong, it's just not normal. The carriage stops and they get out to see the wheat fields, and while the others are having fun, Haruto asks Gold what he would do if the Queen was after Charlotte's life. Gold had anticipated that the Queen was trying to get rid of him, but he would never have thought she was after Charlotte. But since she is the Queen, there is nothing that he can do about it. Harvindiff says it might be better if the Queen just disappeared, but as wicked as she may be, she is still the strongest warrior in the kingdom, and if she disappeared, there would be a civil war to fill the power vacuum. But if someone else of equal power were to take her place, then it would be fine. Hermito suggests that Gold become king, but he knows he is not cut out to be the king. However, he believes that Charlotte would one day be able to rule the kingdom well. Hermito decides to protect Charlotte until she can become queen, and that means putting off killing the Queen. But he still has plans to go see her. The Queen receives a report on the failure to assassinate Charlotte and she is not happy about it. She throws wine in the face of the Knight and calls him useless. The Knight tries to explain that the Black Knight has been foiling all their plans, but the Queen doesn't see what the big deal is with one measly vigilant. She thinks she might just have to take him on herself and put an end to this, and the chance to put her money where her mouth presents itself as Black Knight is right there. The Queen's knights try to guard her, but they are immediately choked out by barriers. The Queen asks how he managed to get into the castle since there should be several layers of barriers around it, but barriers are kind of Black Knight's thing. So it's not like that was going to stop him. She doesn't care anymore and just wants to kill him, so she activates three spells that once in Black Knight is actually pretty impressed. She creates a ball of water around him and tries to drown him, but he just jumps straight out of it. Next, she tries throwing spikes at him. And when that doesn't work, she tries a fireball and she thinks she has finally gotten him. But Black Knight just gets up and goes, "Yep, that was fire all right." It's now his turn to attack and he just casually pelts her with blast after blast until she runs out of mana to defend herself. With no other options, she engages in close combat with the holy sword that killed the Demon King and she exclaims that she is the strongest in the world. But immediately after, she gets disarmed and is now defeated. He still can't kill her, despite how much he wants to, so he puts a collar around her neck that will kill her if she ever does anything against Gold or Charlotte again and leaves her to wait in her defeat. He walked in, asserted dominance, and just left right after. After a long night of asserting dominance, Perudo's threat has kept the queen at bay for 5 years. And now he is spending the day playing with Charlotte in the snow. Not much has changed as Charlotte is still a weeb and FLE is still useless in everything other than the most random things. As Charlotte and FLE continue to play in the snow, Perudo and Gold have a discussion. Gold talks about how the queen hasn't made another attempt on Charlotte's life since 5 years ago and all of a sudden, she started wearing a slave collar. At first the other nobles thought it was just some weird fashion statement, but after a while, they started wondering if she might have been trying something kinky and got stuck in the collar. However, one thing is certain: with Charlotte now safe, he can continue to live his peaceful shut in life. That peace lasted for all 2 seconds as Gold tells him that he has to go to school now. Hermione doesn't want to go and Gold didn't want to send him there, but there are factors that he can't refuse. The king recommended him personally, and it was most likely due to Marion taking an interest in him. It would cause problems if he declined the king's personal offer, so he agrees to go. Gold says he can take an attendant with him, but before he can even think about Flay, Gold says he can't take her, he can't have her chucking fireballs in the school. Just that his mother barges in and says he can take her, but that is basically handing yourself over on a silver plate to the bullies. Gold gives him some time to find someone to take, but Gerudo still has plans for avoiding school altogether. He is going to send his clone instead, but the clone also doesn't want to go. But there is another plan. Since the clone can't use magic, Gerudo would be expelled for lack of ability. He would not have to go anymore. But the clone questions why it has to be him, since if he gets picked on, he doesn't have any main character powers to defend himself. So Corbomu compromises and promises to use barrier magic to make sure he at least doesn't get hurt. In a log cabin in the middle of the woods, Flay is wiping down the windows while Charlotte is watching anime and Gerudo's playing video games. He then suddenly recalls something that his procrastination had led him to neglect. He's still about to find an attendant for the academy unless he wants his mom to go with him. While walking in the forest, Gerudo comes across a barrier in the forest and walks into it only to find that it is the one he created for the skeletons to live in. What else was he going to do with them? After he defeated them 5 years ago, they swore their loyalty to him. So with no idea what to do, Gerudo just gave them some land and chucked them into the wilderness. The leader, Johnny, tells Gerudo that he can order them to do anything he wants, but what he wants to know is why there are other monsters here too. The other monsters are from the monsters that Flay scared the living daylights out of, so now they live here and recover from the PTSD. Gerudo thinks it's fine as long as they don't cause any trouble, but he is still surprised that the settlement seems to have grown quite a bit, and they've even started farming and planning to grow their population. Gerudo starts thinking that Johnny seems to be quite capable, and if he manages to create a body for him, then he might make a perfect attendant. He would be perfect if he didn't talk so much that it. Johnny notices the look on Gerudo's face and asks if he may have done anything wrong. But Gerudo denies it and says he is just impressed with how well Johnny is handling things here. Later, Gerudo sits by the lake and talks to himself about how tired he is. He had thought he could just spend time alone in the forest, but that whole thing happened, and while he is sitting there, the golem pops up behind him and sits down. The golem is named Jig Jin and is a lot more soft-spoken than Johnny. In that respect, Gerudo would like to take her as his attendant, but I assume the academy doesn't make 10-ton beds. As Gerudo walks back to the cabin, he realizes that picking an attendant might actually be really difficult, but seeing as he has learned nothing from his procrastination, he decides to forget about it for now. He returns home and FLE asks him what all this talk of attendance is about, but Gerudo remembers that FLE isn't an option, so he tells her that it has nothing to do with her. The next day, Charlotte starts coming up with new names for things and ends up naming the monster village Pandemonium. But the dragon starts to fly away, so they chase after it. The dragon then takes a nosedive into the mountain and ends up buried by an avalanche. A blizzard dragon losing to snow is pretty ironic. Gold calls Gerudo in to discuss something and tells him about the blizzard dragon that got wounded in the mountains. It hasn't entered their region yet, but if it were to go on a rampage, then there would be several casualties. So he wants FLE to go deal with it, but FLE refuses, stating that she only follows orders from Haruto. But even when Haruto asks her to do it, she still refuses. Her reason is that since she has never met that dragon, it means that it chose not to help during the demon war, and she can't bring herself to talk to such a coward. After talking a little more, they exit the office and Charlotte was outside eavesdropping on the conversation. She asks Flay to please save the dragon. And if both Haruto and Charlotte are asking, she has no choice but to agree. They head to the mountains and Haruto begins scanning the area until he locates the dragon, but adventurers are closing in on it so they have to act fast. The adventurers are about to finish off the dragon, but Haruto jumps in to defend it and heals its wounds. FLE then starts checking fire at the adventurers, who so far have done nothing wrong whatsoever. The dragon gets up and freezes Haruto immediately, which is not how you thank someone for saving you, and after Haruto breaks free, he is really angry. The dragon can speak but ignores Haruto, and asks FLE why she is obeying a human, and this sets off a long, unskippable cut scene. 1 hour later, FLE is done with her speech. The dragon now believes that Haruto is the demon lord and apologizes for not fighting the war between humans and demons. She lived alone for 300 years and doesn't like conflict. She recounts that at first she just slept in a cave, but then an adventurer dropped a book and she loved reading it so much that she left her cave and took on a human form so that she could go to a human village to read books. But while that may seem harmless, she still stole those books from the library and one day adventurers found her and attacked, burning down her pile of stolen books in the process. Kind of hard to feel sorry for her, but FLE seems to be quite moved by the story and invites her to come live in Pandemonium. Haruto agrees to this, and the dragon swears her loyalty to him before transforming into a human. Haruto already knows what is going to happen, so before the fanservice could kick in, he creates clothes for her. Afterwards, he names her Liza. FLE gets jealous and tries to assert dominance here, but Haruto just tells them to follow him home for now, and while Liza is able to sprout wings to follow him, FLE is stuck on the ground. This was the end of episode 6. Thanks for watching, subscribe for more recaps.